Welcome to Caledonia McGrange, where intelligent topical thought sticks its head above the parapet and is immediately shot down by cheap gags. Nelson Mandela visited Al-Megrahi in Barlinnie prison this week. The Libyan bomber said Nelson had brought him hope and perspective, but best of all, 200 cigarettes and a soap on a rope. Scotland is preparing for an invasion by Ectemnius rufocornis, a rare and aggressive species of wasp that nests in deadwood. Entomologists have advised the cast of High Road to wear motorcycle helmets for the foreseeable future. Edinburgh is to charge motorists £2 to enter the city. Following this move, Aberdeen is looking at a similar scheme where motorists will be charged a tenner to leave the city. And Jerry Halliwell is to publish her bulimia diary. And like the ex-Spice Girl, the book will be very thin and well-thumbed. On my left, wry-inspiring Fred McCauley. And on my right, shy-retiring Karen Dunbar. On Fred's team tonight, a comedian whose long list of performing credits include being in Three Fat Ladies at the Fringe, none of whom thankfully pressed charges, Miles Jupp. With Fred and Miles, a man who hopes his Monica of the Glen character Duncan will be given more romantic scenes next series, as long as they don't begin with the words, "Here, boy, Hamish Clark." On Karen's team, a rock god who played with Ultravox, Slick and Thin Lizzy, the other X-Men being unavailable at the time, Midgeur. And joining Karen and Midge, a Sky News presenter whose dad could probably still hold down a place in the current Scotland team. Mind you, so could she, Kelly Dalglish. We begin with Blast from the Past. Fred's team, some men who'd sell their mother for rock and roll.
Scotland, where the highland air is keen, where the islands lie serene, where there's purple heather seen, back to bonny Scotland.
Some fine Scottish heritage there, just for our English friend Miles.
I have to say that in my naivety, I always thought they both sang. I mean, it's obviously Jack sings and Tom just kind of looks bemused at where the wailing's coming from.
So, Miles, does that appeal to you as a visiting Englishman?
Oh, definitely. That's very charming. I like the fact one sings and one just sort of stands there. He's a sort of Bez of 70s Scottish culture.
The spectacular Alexander brothers there. But Fred and team, can you name me three other sets of Scottish musical brothers?
Kindness.
Yes, and what was their name then?
Craig and Charlie Reed.
Yes, well done.
Pat and Greg Kane.
Yep, Hugh and Craig, correct. One more.
The Lorimer brothers out of Bay City Rollers.
Longmuir.
Yeah.
Yes, absolutely correct. Point to Clan McCauley. Karen's team, comic legend in shopping skirmish scandal.
Excuse me.
Excuse me, my doggy bickies, I think.
Nothing of the kind. I've been looking for doggy bickies everywhere.
But I'm afraid you'll just have to go hungry, dear.
Oh. How dare you? I shall call the manager. And I don't often say that. Take your hands off at once.
I'll bet you don't often say that.
All right, Stanley Baxter there. But which famous advertising characters did Stanley lend his voice to?
Kelly. I haven't got a
Yes! Yes! Kelly Dalglish swears, lords!
And the best thing is my granny won't see it because I'll cut it out.
Oh, that's what you think. Can I just say to Kelly's granny, she also wears a thong made of licorice.
How about you have a stab at the correct answer?
This advert character, yes. It was human. It wasn't a cartoon.
But see, it wasn't a cartoon, but it wasn't human either.
Oh, right.
Was it a monkey?
I've kind of given it away almost there. It was a monkey.
Oh, PG Tips.
It was the PG Tips chip. Yeah. That's quite the band. Yeah. Clan McCauley, hold those sides now, lest they split. So round one, fellas, holidays, and Johnny, is it holidays at home or abroad?
Well, 21 years ago, I used to go to Saltcoats. I spent a month there one Sunday. I'll never forget that boarding house. Can you imagine Berlini with window boxes? And the landlady, and there was a hard woman, Arthur Mullard in corsets. I said, what are your lowest terms without swearing? She said, £5 a week and remember, no children. I said, right, I'll be careful.
Yes.
What a set.
What is that?
Looks like my old busty card that I got on the table. You know, they sparkly. No money, bastards.
Have you walked with Johnny Beattie, Fred? And you?
I have, many times. He's a lovely man celebrating his 50th year in show business. Well, I mean, I say show business, it's Scottish show business, which is like show business, but without the whores and the cocaine.
That was the highlight of the 21st anniversary celebrations of STV, there featuring the mighty Johnny Beattie.
Yes.
Fred's team, I would like you all, in turn, to complete this sentence then. I wouldn't say my hotel was rough, but...
I wouldn't say my hotel was rough, but Thomas T.C. Campbell was working the ice cream trolley. What are we going to do now, T.C.?
I wouldn't say my hotel was rough. It wasn't. It was 5-star. It was absolutely lovely.
I wouldn't say my hotel was rough, but you've got visits from Nelson Mandela.
Very good.
I wouldn't say my hotel was rough, but there was sawdust in the minibar.
The roughest hotel I ever stayed in was in Newcastle, and it was £10 a night, and this is about 10 years ago. I was doing stand-up there. Yeah. And I went in after the gig, and I went to my bed, and I was just nodding off, and a couple came into the room next to me, and I realised that the room I was in had been partitioned, right? It was just like, it was like hardboard between me and the other side, and they're a couple, I'm on my own, and yes, it's about 2 o'clock in the morning, they start, right? And they're at it, they're having sex like that. Fortunately, it didn't last very long, and it finished, and I could hear the bloke starting to snore, and she started to greet. She's going, and he wakes up and he goes, what's wrong? And she goes, my tits are too small. He's going, they're fine, go to sleep. My tits are too small. Eventually, I'm going, they're fine. Go to sleep. I went down to breakfast the next morning, there's one couple sitting in the dining room like that, and I walked past and I'm going, I see what you mean.
It feels almost cruel after that wonderful entertainment to ask you a serious question as well.
Right.
But I will do. In that clip, who hosted that ritual slaughter of all things funny?
I know, it's definitely a Steve.
It is a Steve.
But I don't know which Steve. I'm no point in asking you.
No idea.
No idea at all. Steve.
Would you like to guess at a surname, Miles?
Jones.
Absolutely correct. A point to Clan Macaulay.
Well done. Oh.
And finally, Clan Dunbar, some really cheesy guy giving it the old, oh, I'm really nervous, will you fancy me routine?
Roger, you're sensible. If you were me, which of these would you concentrate on? Career, kids or men?
Can I suggest a fourth option? Well, it reminds me of the words of that song. Shouldn't I have this? Shouldn't I have this? Shouldn't I have all of this and passionate kisses? Dum dum dum. Passionate kisses. Whoa ho ho. Passionate kisses from you.
Thank you. Thank you.
I tell you, Hamish, I'm really glad you've sorted your hair out for there.
But what this side of the audience couldn't see was he was singing along. With
I so wasn't.
You so were.
That was a cheeky chappy Hamish doing his cheeky chappy routine on My Wonderful Life in 1997. But Karen's team, can you tell me three other singing doctors?
Dr. Hook.
Dr. Hook, yes. That's one.
Doctor and the Medics.
Doctor and the Medics, yeah.
Dr. Zhivago. Dr. Robert
from the Blue Monkeys.
Yes. Dr.
From
Robert,
the Blue Monkeys.
Yes, so he said that. It's a point to Clan Dunbar. And at the end of that first round, both teams are neck and neck on 2 points each. Time now for our waste of a stamp round. Each team reads out three letters. One of them appeared in the Sunday Post. The other two are as false as the average Sunday Post reader's teeth. Fred's team, unfurl your missives. Miles, you can speak off first.
The reason that we don't have good footballers anymore is because everywhere you go, you see signs saying no ball games. How are we boys supposed to learn their Tanner Bar skills if they've nowhere to play?
I think it's Tanner Bar. Tanner Bar skills, not Tanner
Bar. It's certainly not English, whatever it is.
Fred, let's hear your one.
I wonder if any other readers know how to get rid of the taste of licorice.
Take your phone off!
Sorry, just lost my mind for a minute there. The real letter begins, Dear Sir, I collect the little photographs of towns that come wrapped around stalks of rock. The only holiday place I haven't got is Prestwick. Could any reader be kind enough to help me complete my collection?
And finally, Hamish Clark.
In this day of high technology, you'd think that someone would invent an electric kettle that whistled when the water was boiled. Electric kettles click off quietly, but if they whistled, you'd clearly know when it was time for tea.
Not as crazy as it might sound, Clan Dunbar. Which was the real one? Hamish's whistling electric kettle, Miles's Tanner Ba, or Fred's rock?
Well, sitting here feeling a bit like a stalk of rock myself tonight, as in needing a good suck. That'll never go in!
Here's your dad in the phone.
Kelly made me day at dad, then ran away. Do you know who her dad is? Well, that's made it all better. Right, what do you think then?
The really sad bit is that they all sound very feasible.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I want it to be the rock one. I really, really want it to be the, because I think I could help. I have that sticker up with a picture of Prestwick on it.
When would you ever in Prestwick, Kelly?
I've been to the airport.
Prestwick, shut up.
The airport sells rock.
I think we've got to go for the rock. It's so stupid, it's probably real.
Let's go for this Fred's stock of rock Prestwick style.
Right, Fred McCauley was your Sunday Post letter true or false?
I'm delighted to say it was false.
No! It wasn't true, the sticker rock, so who had the real Sunday Post letter?
Oh,
it was Miles. Karen's team, let's hear your immaculately intelligent observations. Starting with you, Midge.
You can keep your Supermans and your Batmans and your Spidermans. My favourite superhero is Desperate Dan. Because in these days of eating disorders, his healthy appetite and cow pie lunches is a lesson to us all. And I think Jerry Halliwell should listen to this.
Absolutely. Karen, let's hear your one.
What has happened to our weather? Back in the 1940s, the hot summers seemed to go on for months on end. I remember that I was forever removing melted tar from my kids' feet with butter. Which is a bit worrying, really, isn't it? That it'd be like, right, now I want you to go to the shop and I want you to get me £2. So off you went out there and make it £3 of butter.
And finally, Kelly, let's hear your one.
Right, when you go abroad, they tell you not to drink the tap water. But judging by our water standards in Scotland today, we should be warning tourists to our country not to drink the muck that comes out of our taps.
OK, Fred's team's Kelly's manky water, mm-hmm. Midge's Desperate Dance superhero are Karen's tarred feet, which is the real Sunday Post letter.
Well, we needn't ask Miles whether butter removes tar from bare feet, because I would imagine everyone you know has been well shod.
isn't butter, don't you put it like on cat's paws when you move house, and they spend all the time licking them so they don't know they're missing. I imagine they did a similar thing during the Highland Clearance.
Keep that. So we're not going for the butter.
So they put it on cat's paws for what?
Your cat's paws, and then when you're driving off or whatever,
yeah.
Say, I don't know, say originally you lived in Cardiff and you moved to Oh, Swansea. Right, bit of a way or whatever. Yeah. So your cat has a honing instinct or whatever.
Yeah.
To try and sort of get through that, to transcend that, what you do, you put butter on the cat's paws and he spends the whole journey licking it off. And then you get the other end, you open it, he's like, oh. He doesn't know where he is, doesn't know where he's come from, okay. And that way he won't run away home.
Oh, are we moving then? I thought we are in Cardiff.
I've only gone and got butter on my paws.
I think all three of us would probably go for Kelly.
No, I wouldn't.
But as for the letter, it's Kelly. It's
Kelly's one about the manky water.
Kelly Dalglish, is that true?
I'm so pleased it's not.
No, it's not! Oh. It's OK, who's got the real letter?
For a buttery taste.
It was the top piece! So, at the end of that round, we still have a draw, and it is still two apiece. Time now to divert our eyes towards our What's Missing round. The following pictures have danced nakedly about our newspapers this week, but we are covering them up with white bits in the name of decency and hopefully humour. Fred's team, what's missing here?
The chalk eyes. Or a feast.
I do actually know the story. It was in the press this week that a chimpanzee or a minky, they're not sure which, because I think they fingerprinted it and they weren't too sure, broke into a house down south and nicked a couple of mobile phones.
Yes, it was a crime, but what's missing?
Oh, it's a mobile phone.
It is a mobile phone. That's a point to Claire McCauley. Yes, the story is the monkey burglar that Gina Davison believes broke into her house and stole her mobile phone. It's not the loss of the phone that angers me, Gina said. It's the fact that the robber will take it to a local pub and sell it for peanuts. Karen's team, what's Ozzy got his hands on?
Hopefully a very small effigy of Cliff Richard that he's going to bite the head off.
Is it a double nugget?
A double nugget.
I wanted an oyster.
Okay.
What is that?
Correct answer time.
Is it?
It's an alien.
Is it where his inside used to be, and his intestine and everything all been sucked out, and that's he's got a big fat heart. No. Maybe not.
No, that's incorrect. I can't give you a point for that. It is actually Kermit the Frog. That's the legendary rocker Ozzy Osbourne at the Jubilee concert, joined by the equally legendary Kermit the Frog. Ozzy said he was delighted to meet the famous wide mouth puppet. And after he'd met Will Young, he was introduced to Kermit. Oh, yeah, like you really like him. A year from now, we'll be serving you chips. So, at the end of that round, we have daylight between the teams. Clan Dunbar behind on three, Clan McCauley ahead with four.
Oh, my God.
Time now for After Heather, starring those funny tales that appear in the news after Heather, the perfectly nice weather girl, has left the studio bound for the river with a sack that looks suspiciously like it may be filled with puppies. This is the last show, and we're off on a holiday straight after, so here's some tips for Fred's team.
It's the expectation that you are going to be able to do things on holiday that you can't do at home. The Scots culture is particularly Calvinistic still.
Definitely, like, Spanish girls love the Scots. Things they hate. Gets you going.
I think that many European residents find the Scots quite exotic and different.
like who?
That was Dr. David Weeks, a man that I know well.
How do you know him, Fred?
He gives me psychological advice. We've been dating since we met in Spain.
So what was the gist of that report, Lynn?
He's talking about our Calvinistic culture, and you have to go to Spain so you can do things that you can't do here, like presumably sing on Sundays. Mm-hmm. Maybe that's why the Spanish girls love a bit of us Scots lads.
With a carefree singing on a Sunday.
Singing on a Sunday. Take that, you bitch. It just seems to me particularly silly. I've never been to Spain. I once accidentally went to Spain. I did. Because I was in France. And it's a long story made short. I was in a bit
Please.
Of France.
That's it.
All right, long story kept long. No, it is like, That's in the little bottom bit of France called dead posh French place. And I fell asleep. I was on a yacht, actually, at a party, and I fell asleep, and when I woke up, I was in Spain. It was Sunday, I was singing, the chicks were on me like magnets.
Yeah. I was in Spain in 1977, which I think was the year I saw Slick in the Sally Hotel in Perth. Spain, 1977, and we were five young lads, and we're all going off on holiday. On the way out, the five of us put £2 each into a kitty, and the first of us to get laid got the tenner. And do you know what happened? We split the money up in the flight home.
Miles, where did you go on holiday as a child?
My grandpa used to take me around the former British Empire, weeping copiously.
So by the time he licked the butter off his hands, he was home.
We've got as far as saying Scottish people could go abroad to do things they wouldn't be able to do at home, namely what?
Go to water parks. Which we can do here. Well, we can. I mean, it's just like going for a walk here. Effectively. But, which reminds me of another anecdote I've got. We were in Spain last year and went to a water park, and I was having a nightmare of a day. I was asked to leave because I didn't have a tattoo. It was hideous. Full of people. And I was in the queue. I had to go and get some food for the kids, and I thought, oh, we're on holiday, what the hell? there was some guys standing behind me, and they're going, oh, there's that Fred Macaulay off the telly, all right? And I'm ignoring them. And I know, Kelly, you can speak some Spanish, and I got to the front of the queue, and I said, dos bocadillos e uno café olé. And the bloke behind me goes, oh, it can't be Fred Macaulay, that geezer's a Spaniard.
I'll give you one more stab at what the crux of the piece was.
Is it about lots of Scottish people go on holiday abroad purely for the purpose of having sex?
I'm sad, but very true. A point to Clare Macaulay. Yes, that is a report that 14% of Scottish holidaymakers travel abroad for the sole purpose of getting sex. Strangely, that's exactly the same percentage of Scottish people who are ginger. Just a coincidence. Karen's team are carrying on the holiday theme somewhat.
The Scottish link with the Lancashire seaside town goes back to its heyday as a holiday mecca. But this year, the beaches tell their own story.
Well, the first time must be 30 years ago, since we come, but we haven't been coming every year.
Oh, I've been here 18 years running, I came.
5 o'clock dinner is regimental, really, I suppose, but they like it that way. If ours,
Bobby's girl. But still, the cabaret singers can make a living in the small hotels.
That's me! You are just back from Blackpool.
Yeah, I was there last week.
Did they give you a go in the karaoke?
Oh, God.
Do you go into places and they go, oh, there's Midge, Midge, come on up and sing. We all stood still.
No, they go, this Midge's dad, look. That's a bit like him.
There's a bit at the beginning which I thought was really good, where there's people doing things that I don't remember doing when I was doing the show. And there it is. It's like, oh, Veronica, we're here, we're at Blackpool. What would you like to do? Well, I think I'll bend over, and if you jump over me, and we all go in a line, and we can jump and skip on the sand. And then the other one's raging. She's like, no, I've been waiting all day for you to jump over me, Veronica. And that's it, I'm off. Bugger you.
I was there last week, really. And everyone seems to be walking about with these huge afro wigs, massive big things, tartan shorts. And at the back of the tartan shorts, there's a plastic arse sticking out the end.
Is that the other percentage of people that don't go to Spain to get shagged, go to Blackpool to get laughed at?
We might as well not get a shag, Ken. No. We might as well just go and eat lip buggery. That's what we'll do. Wear arses and wigs and that, because we're not looking for humping, no.
What was that clip about then, specifically? It was Blackpool, but what was the point?
I went to Blackpool because there's more Scots there than there are here.
Or is there?
Oh, there's a clue in that, which has been...
That's not
right
a clue,
over
I don't
head. Like a giraffe's ass right over my head. So, thank you, Midge. Slow burner.
Oh, God.
Is the Scots going to Blackpool on holiday?
That's the story.
I think so.
I've been so kind to you throughout the series, actually. No, the whole story is that they're not going anymore.
Oh, so that was what the empty beaches were for?
It's a fall-off in numbers.
That's all those women that you noticed doing leapfrog. They've gone.
That's Blackpool there and its struggle to recapture the Scottish visitors of its past. Numbers have gradually fallen as more and more Scottish people realise that if they want to experience hilarious cabaret, dancing clowns and a million ways to lose money, they can sit in the gallery of the Scottish Parliament. So, after our penultimate round then, we have got Karen's team on 3, romping ahead with 5, Fred's team. It's quickfire time now, but again, a holiday thing here, not questions as such, postcards from famous Scottish folk who have gone off and hit the beaches already. I'm going to read out the postcard and then buzz in if you can tell me who sent it to me with love and kisses. First postcard, not really enjoying the Far East tour. The canine cuisine is nicked so good, and I can't seem to score. Clamacolly.
Bertie Volt.
Bertie Volt. These all-inclusive deals are great, what with the free food and drink. If only the other people here were not such irritating bampots. Yes, Miles?
Sandy in the Big Brother house.
Absolutely correct. Point to Clamacolly. The skirt here is fantastic. Some bird even broke into my apartment with a carry-out. Clandama.
Jack McConnell.
Correct, yes. Seeing a lot of the world very quickly, but everywhere I go, there's a German already there. Yes, Clandama.
Bertie Votes again.
No, not Bertie Votes.
Vera Lynn.
She's Scottish.
The Queen Mother.
Only her total non-Scottishness. <Rosa. laughs>
Look in the mirror, there's a German.
Very, very good, Kevin. Not quite the correct answer. It was David Coulthard. My favourite postcard here. London's great. Bit of trouble with a wife, though. I've got to do all my own ironing now.
Trevor from EastEnders.
Trevor from EastEnders, correct, Kelly. Oh, and the final postcard, it's a short one. Hiya. Calandama.
Lorraine Kelly?
It is Lorraine Kelly! And at the end of our final show, it's been a long time happening again, but Clandamba is this week's loser with 6, but this week's winner with 7, Clamacolly! Okay, that is the bells for this show. Helping prop up this great comedy bar has been Fred McCauley, Miles Jupp and Hamish Clark, Karen Dunbar, Midgeur and Kelly Dalglish. That's the last show in the series, so I'm not stupid enough to read out next week's guest, but I am cruel enough to reveal that that's only the second one Fred has won in the entire run. And finally, following the shock exit of champions France from the World Cup, French officials have launched an inquiry into their disastrous performance. Apparently, they're DNA testing the team to see if they're Scottish. But of course, we can't leave without saying congratulations to England for making it through to the next round of the World Cup. Everyone is really happy that you're staying out there in Japan, apart from Ulrika, who's gagging for it. I am Dominic Diamond. This series has been the best fun I've had since I discovered pornography. Good night.